Ron Scapp. He is the founding director of the Graduate Program of Urban and Multicultural Education at the College of Mount St. Vincent in the Bronx, where he is professor of humanities and teacher education. He is the immediate past president of the National Association for Ethnic Studies. He is also a member of the International Committee for Kappa Delta Pi. He has been a longtime fellow at the National Educational Policy Center at the University of Colorado Boulder. Dr. Scapp has written and edited numerous books on a variety of subjects and topics, from popular culture to education, from social and political philosophy to art criticism. And he is, with Dean Anthony Tamburi, the guest co-editor of the Italian-American Culture issue of the journal Differentia. He was recently a visiting scholar at Teachers College, Columbia University.
If I could begin by saying I'm going to be, I think, pretty short in my actual formal presentation because of some of the overlap in both papers. And I'm just actually tickled that sometimes panels actually come together. So if I can indulge in a moment, what I would like to say, the article you quoted from Bell Hooks, Eating the Other, was published in the journal, in the anthology I edited called Eating Culture. And it's a cool anthology and was at the birth of food studies. And Anna, I want to invite you to contribute to a book I'm editing called Being in Transit on travel, place, and culture, if you're tempted. And as a trifecta of coincidence, Peter Caravetta many years ago and I taught at Queens College, and we got to talking. And my PhD is in philosophy, I do all the French stuff, blah, blah, blah. And Peter was talking about wanting to get a different sense of Italian studies and Italian-American studies in the United States beyond just the folks who talk to each other about it all the time. And we came up with the Italian-American volume of Differentia, which is amazingly, I think, still very current in terms of its strategy and its approach. So what I want to do today is talk about doing my own kind of field work. And as also a nice coincidence, my father lived, retired to Tampa, dragged me to that place. He's Corsican and Sicilian, and was complaining about this, that, and the other thing. But we drove there in his Lincoln, in his black Cadillac. He just died, he's 92, he drove until close to his death. And when I met my wife on St. Mark's Place downtown, she was nevertheless living in Verona, Italy, and taking these drives up into the Dolomites to hike. And so we visited all these areas. And so it's a nice coincidence. And I'm talking about going to and from Eataly, the Mario Batali establishment. Do folks know about this? Yeah. While you're in town, go. And it's going to be a kind of glib, not trashing of it, but questioning of some of the dynamic about the high-low cultural issues, the erasure of Italian culture in the presentation of it, even when it's being presented as something high-end. In Differentia, in Differentia, I usually don't talk in mics. In Differentia, we were talking about the high-low dynamic in Italian-American culture from, you know, the Renaissance artist to the mobster and so on and so forth. And so I'm going to try to reinvoke some of that here quickly, perhaps so we could talk more with you guys. In 1994, Anthony Tamburi and I were invited by Peter Caravetta to guest edit a special issue of Differentia on Italian-American culture. We collected a wide range of engaging articles about the complexities, dynamics, of identity, politics, and culture. And while there had been other works addressing similar issues, that volume of Differentia incorporated and integrated cultural theory, ethnic studies, and identity politics from a perspective informed and influenced by postmodernism, and therefore offered, I believe, an innovative take on the traditional conflicts and appraisals previously noted about Italian-American culture. My provisional and cursory, that is to say my brief commentary this evening regarding going to and from Eataly continues the approach taken in that issue of differentia, and just as that issue of the journal did, I hope to provoke a few thoughts and considerations about a cultural and economic phenomenon that is generating yet another layer of meaning to what is Italian. An understanding, if one could call it that, predicated on the consumption of, the possession of, and the habitation with products from and within Italy. The newly established arbiter of all things Italian for many shoppers and diners who come and go there. I live on 18th Street, it's on 23rd Street. It is a huge, huge place. Thousands upon thousands of square feet. I'll make another reference to that in a moment. What I want to highlight in the time I have today is the extraordinary way in which Italy gets simultaneously presented and represented as a cultural artifact to be enjoyed, consumed, and experienced via Eataly, the mechanism transporting Italy to New York and New Yorkers and the many, many, many tourists who enter Eataly to Italy. The strategic commodification of the aromas, flavors, of the foods, the produce is on a scale never seen before. I don't have the time to go into it now, but it's amazing how they map out every square inch of that space. And they're very careful about what's next to the cheese, how that wafts. So it is like Epcot Center in a way, because you know how between the German pavilion and the Mexican, they have like the Muzak, so that you're kind of in a neutral zone. Yeah. They're doing stuff like that as well. Stuff to be eaten and stuff to be bought and taken out. Eataly, I want to note, is decidedly not an Italian specialty shop. It is, I would argue, as its name suggests, more a nation state. One populated not by Italians, by Italians. Apparently a global citizenry traversing the various provinces of Italy, Italy's commercial landscape. When we enter Eataly, we enter the domain of the empire of Mario Batali, Lydia and Joe Bastianacci, and the founder of Eataly, Oscar Farinetti, a global kingdom with outposts in Asia, in the Middle East, North and South America, and of course, Europe. What has been magnificently promoted, what has been a magnificently promoted launch of the Eataly brand belies, in my opinion, the still lingering and problematic binary opposition between the Eataly embraced, understood, and promoted as high culture, and the Eataly, and specifically Italian Americans, as the polar opposite, namely the opposition between purity and corruption, integrity and suspicion, value and ripoff, on all a number of levels, culinarily, fashion. You could do this, I think, in across multiple things. If you look at the fashion industry and Italian fashion engagement and designers, music, and food. In short, the historically established dynamic of migratory peoples and things coming and going to Eataly and elsewhere generally. So in this case, I would like to say that in the successful promotion of Eataly, there is an undermining, ignoring, and devaluing of the very migratory characters of Italians in the United States and elsewhere, for example, Argentina, just one example. Eataly, in essence, erases the flawed and complicated and problematic history and dynamic of emigrating from Eataly for Italians and presents and represents a realm of being Italian, rid of the messy history of migration, of relocation, dislocation, and of integration to the extent that it's done. Despite the importation of goods from Eataly, Eataly is firmly established here, fixed as it were, bypassing the many obstacles and issues of the just arrived immigrant reality for individuals and families. With the promotion of terms like freshness, as opposed to the lived experience of being out of place, what newly arrives at Eataly is excellent and quality product. We get a highly aestheticized and codified essence rather than immigrants, refugees, and individuals with dubious providence. unlike the costly items that can be traced to the best farms, cheese and chocolate factories, and the best vineyards of Italy. With the rise of Italy's supremacy of presenting and representing Italy, real Italians and Italian Americans disappear or get reconfigured, actually replaced, onto the many photographs of Italians eating, drinking, and working that hang on the walls of Italy throughout the thing. So not unlike the pictures you had at the market, they are reproducing this at a much more self-consciously sophisticated, stylized, black and white, beautiful people, et cetera, et cetera. So, but please don't get me wrong. Like I said, I live close by. Even a quick stroll through Eataly reveals its many wonderful offerings. Incredible fish, meat, produce, dried and prepared goods of all sorts. I shop there 3 or 4 times a week. I don't know. But I go really early before it opens up. It's an incredible, and so if we had a little bit more time, I would go into the fact that the shops, like the fishmonger at Eataly, supplies the fish to the fish restaurant at Eataly. And the butcher supplies the meat to the, so he has a fish restaurant in Eataly, a meat restaurant in Eataly, a pasta restaurant in Eataly, a pasta making concession in Eataly. They also have a vegetarian restaurant. They also have a pizza restaurant, a beer garden up on the top floor. It's like 80,000 square feet. They have a cooking school, and that school has a restaurant. So it's impressive, but what I want to suggest is that the place is, in its massiveness and its armies of staff roaming and maneuvering throughout Eataly, is impressive, but also there's something oppressive about it, as one needs to negotiate and navigate one's way through the hordes of shoppers and diners, as well as the staff constantly putting out more and more goods and running supplies from one end of the store to one of the many restaurants in Eataly. And there's an interesting beer garden on the top floor, which is good, but you can't get in from now until October because all the Wall Street guys come up and start drinking at around 3:30 in the afternoon. Forbes, by the way, identified Eataly to be the most profitable business space in New York City per square foot. Now, of course, they were only identifying places that actually sell goods and services, as opposed to the billions of dollars that get made and lost in little cubicles down in Wall Street and around the world. But for real retail space, it is the highest grossing retail space per square foot in New York City. For my purposes here this afternoon, as I mentioned earlier, I'm merely presenting a musing about Eataly and developing, and therefore admittedly, a very incomplete polemic regarding what the hell Eataly is really about in terms of the impact on the way we look at Italian material culture and identities. I am suspicious that even a grand palace like Eataly, that there are simultaneously forces at work that undermine and undervalue the very representation and presentation of many fine things from Eataly. In the vast space that is Eataly, the actual place Eataly gets removed from our imagination and is at best otherwise transformed into a Disneyland playground for gourmands and tourists, but ultimately takes us further and further away from the very people still migrating, including Italians, still struggling to make a living somewhere, struggling to put down some modest roots, never mind building an empire. And perhaps that's the real hook here, that in the act of empire building, which is what they're doing, right? This is a massive commercial success, and Mario Batali has an empire now. That in the act of building an empire, we are reminded of the inherent violence and devaluation of the people and things that Michael Hart and Antonio Negri note in their important book, Empire. In an odd moment of commercial reinvention, Eataly replaces Eataly, which is part of the declining confederation of European states. And instead of any meaningful material engagement, we are offered only a rarefied and overtly commodified notion of what Eataly may have been. We enter, or maybe, we enter Eataly unaware of the effects of living within an empire, and I mean that both within the Mario Batali empire and the empire we currently live in here in the United States. Within an empire, even a culinary one. So perhaps we need to be cautious for the moment, for the time being, as we find ourselves going to and from Eataly and other such centers of cultural distribution.
Well, I want to thank you for that. Those musings are what a lot of us have been thinking about. We spend money there, but maybe holding our nose a little bit. But I want to just, if I may, read in this issue of iItaly magazine a statement from Joe Bastianich, who's one of the millionaire owners of Eataly. This is, quote, "I've introduced Americans to everything from the Enoteca, the pizzeria, the osteria, to the most classic Italian restaurant," which I think speaks to the arrogance of that empire building that goes on and on. And what gets me about Eataly, maybe you can say something about this, is the relentless...
Stay by the microphone. Oh, sorry. Otherwise, you remember we're live streaming.
Yeah.
Sorry about that.
The relentless self-authorizing iconography in that store, pictures of, not of just ordinary chic Italians, but Lydia and Mario, and almost everywhere you turn, there's another Maoist-type picture display of these celebrity leaders who's, you know, it's incredible.
The realm of Eataly may be fascist.
And they've erased not just Eataly, but they've erased the Italian-American experience that made possible this empire in the first place.
I think you, in asking your question, actually did a wonderful summary of what my response would have been.
I think that's it.
And my own work is more in sort of like cultural philosophical. You know, I'm a philosopher. I make crap up, so I don't know what the hell I'm talking about. But what I wanted to emphasize was that the dynamic that's inherent in something like the appropriation of the essence of a culture, when it's done at this level, has certain inherent problems that cannot be ignored. Now, on a superficial level, best fish in town, right? Great pasta. But that's not what I'm concerned about.
The most expensive too, right?
To their credit, they know how to, here's what's funny about it. They have capers, for example, in brine that is $3, and it looks exactly like the capers in olive oil for $40.
Okay.
And they're right next to each other. I can't tell you how many times I go home going, how the hell did I spend $70 and all I bought was $3 capers?
Other questions? You can get a great slice of focaccia too there for $2.50, by the way. $2.50, unbelievable. Questions?
I guess maybe since I just have a comment from living in Eataly, Eataly is where I teach at the University of Bologna. For Lee, they opened a store there in the piazza. So I find this fascinating of Italians selling Italian to Italians.
Well, the
selling Eataly to Italian. I mean, this is like multiple layers of replication to the
That's
own
right.
people, and then it becomes totally unmoored from anything cultural. But an interesting thing was is that my watch repair person, they complained because Eataly has made deals with the city councils to not pay taxes. They have tax abatements on these areas. And we all know that Italian piazza, the city centers are dying, but then they allow these, what they basically are, is just multinational corporations.
Well, two quick points, right? Eataly, most Americans don't know, was founded in Eataly by an Italian. And he sold a partnership to the Batali group. And so it is an interesting and odd thing that it touches upon things that I'm interested in terms of on class and gender and race issues about the notion about authenticity, repetition, and originality. So it's like Ray's Pizza, right? There's 8,000 original famous Ray's. Someone's lying, but they all claim deal. And what they do is there's a successful business model, right? There's a successful business model. So New York itself is a repetition of a ripoff of New Amsterdam. So at our birth, New York is inherently has this problem of authenticity, originality, and repetition. So why not, with Ray's Pizza?
Thank you. We're going to finish up. Okay. We can one final round of applause for these three incredible panelists. I think it was a wonderful way to round out the conference. And at this point in time, I would like to invite Joseph Shora to the microphone to say a few last words for us. It's been an incredible time.
Before you go, Dean Tambori was not able to stay until the last moment, so he's asked me to say just a few concluding words. I want to thank you all, those who presented, those who attended, for making this what I think has been a really fascinating conference. And I want to thank you all. You should thank yourselves. And keep in mind that if you haven't heard it from me already, I will be communicating with those who have presented about future publications of the works that came out of this session or out of this conference. Every year is a different theme. Last year was children, bambini, ragazzi, giovani. This year is material culture. Next year will be sound. We'll be sending out the Italian soundscapes, and we'll be sending out the call for papers in the next few weeks. And I hope some of you will be coming back, and we hope some of you will be spreading the word of the Calandra Institute's perspective on Italian diaspora culture. So thank you very much.